The town I grew up in is spelled LaFontaine, like Pat LaFontaine, but the Hoosiers in us all say La Fountain, on State Road 15, North Central Indiana. And the gym was the only important place in the town because it was Indiana and it was basketball. We had a professional team in Fort Wayne, 40 miles away, called the Fort Wayne Pistons. At the same time, we had a hockey team called the Fort Wayne Comets. To this day, the Comets are still there, and the Pistons are not, because the Pistons were common. You could go around the corner and see any good basketball game, but you couldn't see hockey anywhere else in the state. And so, when I was in grade 7, I finally was able to convince my parents that an evening at a hockey game would be a good thing. And from that point on, I was hooked. I grew up listening to everything that moved on radio. And Bob Chase, who still does the broadcast of the Fort Wayne Comets game, he's 82, that's his 56th year. I grew up listening to him and I thought, if this guy can do it, maybe I can do it too if I get lucky enough. I would go into an empty section of the Coliseum in Fort Wayne and do the game to myself into a real archaic battery-powered reel-to-reel tape recorder. Even took the faculty of Miami University once and put them in the game as the Fort Wayne team and the students as Toledo and changed all the names around. But it was just a way to try to practice. But when it came time to send out audition tapes, that was all I had. I'd never done a game over the air to anybody. And after I had a master's degree, I started sending tapes out of all of these phantom games that I had done but nobody'd ever heard. And remarkably, nobody wanted me to come and do their games. So I had to get some kind of other work, so I started teaching at a small college. Bowling Green offered me the chance of teaching two college courses to the undergrads and the second period of the hockey game while I was working on the doctorate. I started in Port Huron in the International League in 1973. That was my very first season in the hockey life. This was what I'd always wanted to do, and it was the league I grew up watching. So these were players that I'd been a fan of, that I was now going to broadcast their games. It was 160 bucks a week, and it was all the pucks I could pick up. And I could go to practice, and I could do the morning sports show, and they paid me for it.
The time I met him, I was coaching in college, and he was, you know, broadcasting for Bowling Green. And then it goes to the International League. And here he is, you know, in the National Hockey League. He never worried about being the best. He just worried about doing things right.
And I finished the dissertation 3 years later in 1976. And in my first job in Maine, the president of the team saw that I had a doctorate, and he started calling me Doc. It's not a terribly creative nickname, but he's the one that hung it on me, and it's been there ever since. The IHL, that was fairly low budget, and the security of being with a Philadelphia Flyers farm team, because the Flyers had money, and they'd just won a championship 2 years before, so they had money. And you knew that if they put a farm team in Portland, Maine, they would not only stock it with good players, but they'd spend money on it, which meant that it would last from 1 year to the other, and it sure did.
Gorin's top of the circle to Dunlop, a shot, score!
The Flyers promote from within, so I was fortunate to move right on into the NHL from there. I began with the Flyers in 1980. I was there for 3 years. I was the home play-by-play guy on local pay cable. The New Jersey Devils, in affiliation with Madison Square Garden Network in 1983, offered me the chance to do all the games, home and road. As Dave Lewis, a member of the team, later said, it was one of the best groups of guys you'd ever want to be around that couldn't win a hockey game. That was the Devils from 83 to 86. Madison Square Garden, they needed somebody to do Rangers radio to back up Marv Albert. So for 2 years, I stayed with Madison Square Garden Network doing Rangers on radio. At the same time, they allowed me to pick up an opportunity that ESPN offered to do the national games with Bill Clement. By 1988, we had had that stretch going, and Bill and I were offered the television job in Philadelphia. So I was there for 5 years, and I had an opportunity to go to what turned out to be Madison Square Garden Network again, doing Devils games, and I've been there ever since.
Here's a feed in front that was away from Gianta, went off an Islander and on goal, and was stopped by McDonald. Back to Martin, gives to Langenbrunner, fires, score!
It's two men. Lou Lamoriello comes in from Providence College. They've never made the playoffs. they start making the playoffs. Along comes Marty Brodeur in 1993. Now you've got the goaltender that can win you a championship. Almost did in 94. Rangers took it away.
Call them on. Save! Rebound! Score! Messier!
Game 6 at the Meadowlands, 1994. The Rangers are trailing the Devils 3-2. Marc Messier comes out in the newspaper and guarantees a victory.
Messier throws it down and in! The stop of legend. The called shot. The hat trick.
But from that point on, the Devils have been an upper echelon team. In 1995, the Devils were going up against the Detroit Red Wings, overpowering team. But in that lockout-shortened year, the two teams hadn't played against one another. Now, the Devils are supposed to lose to Detroit in the best of 7, 3 games straight, and then forfeit the 4th game because Detroit's so overwhelmingly powerful. Well, now they won the first 3.
Stephon Richey, center, ricochet off front, they score!
The 4th game was, I think, probably the crowning moment of the Devils becoming an elite franchise.
Come on in front!
And John Davidson, in a commercial break, turns to me and says, Doc, I was through this last year. You just enjoy these next 7 minutes, because they're going to go fast, but they're going to be long-time memories for you.
The championship to New Jersey. The Devils win the Stanley Cup.
And I did, and they've been long-time memories. In 1997, at the old Meadowlands in New Jersey, it's Montreal, the home of Marty Brodeur during his growing up years, up against the New Jersey Devils. Montreal had to pull the netminder to have any kind of chance, and it was dumped in, and Marty stepped back and wheeled it.
Brodeur controlling, the net is empty, he throws it down, and in! He scored a goal! Martin Brodeur!
We have a lot of guys who have had great skill and some that have not, but they've all bought into the team concept. But the real plus for us is we get to be around a winner. Not everybody gets that.
All right, let's start the meeting off. We got the Isles, 6:30 pregame, 7 o'clock telecast. Excuse me, Doc, what would you like to try to get on?
13 for the Islanders, 23 for the Devils, and the panel on the various Islanders that are out with injuries. Right now, they got 7 guys. He's got a first, a second, a third, and a fourth.
Ooh.
Terrific. Okay, thanks.
Right. We knocked out the tees. Thank you, Doc. We'll roll the open. We'll bump in. Wide shot with title page. Steve sets it up in the goal ball, and he gets it up to Doc and Chico in the booth.
Zajac, 2 assists, 13 and 6 on faceoffs in the win against the Rangers. 3rd on the team in goals, 3rd in points, tied for 3rd in assists, and 1st on the team in plus minus at 27.
If Steve chooses to do a guest, then we'll just move everything down. JT, keep Doc as a safety valve. All right, everyone, let's get started.
Well, back in September in training camp, a certain player named Zajac said, I'm going to be better in all departments, especially faceoffs this year.
The atmosphere of our telecast is so spontaneous. You don't have to feel like you have to prepare things to say. I think people can spot it when you're plotting things anyway. They almost sound forced.
We know that goalies are special and among the best people in the world, but they need game action too, don't they?
They do.
You know, it's like if you went to play with Wayne Gretzky in your prime, there'd be a little bit of intimidation. And we had a little bit of working out. I mean, Mike a couple times would be like a good coach and kind of say to me, Chico, this is something you can't do. This isn't going to work. He'd always say, sell it like it's the greatest thing that the fans ever heard, like a dump-in. That was the greatest dump-in I've ever seen. Now, it's like a line that has chemistry.
Is it a 2 or is it a 4? They're checking over Jamie Langenbrenner right now.
If you don't cut the guy but you knock his tooth out, ooh, ouch. Would that be a 5? I think it should be. Blood or a tooth?
We both see the game of hockey as being a sport that you need the play-by-play man to still bring the excitement to the viewers.
Stand by face-off.
And ready, 1. And set by drop.
Remarkable keep by Opozo, and Opozo dances by, comes in front, save, rebound, score!
Hey, digital replay, digital replay.
Ready, 1. Nice keep in line. Ready, 1, take 1. Ready, 5, take 5.
Stand by red, whip.
Ready, 6, take 6, ready, take the red.
And go.
And take the red.
Second digital replay. Commercial in five, four, three, two, one.